And I call the book When Two Loves Collide because their passionate love for each other began to collide with their passionate love for their addictions. And it created chaos in their lives. They lost almost everything.
I also wrote a book, wrote a movie called My Name is Bill W. and a book called The Lois Wilson Story, When Love is Not Enough. And that was about the relationship between Bill Wilson and Lois Wilson, the co-founder of AA and the co-founder of Al-Anon. And when I was writing the book about Dr. John Mooney and his wife died, so many times in writing that book, it reminded me of what Bill and Lois went through. And the pain and the suffering, but the love and the commitment that they had that bound them together. And that's what I found in the relationship of your parents, is that tremendous love and commitment. No matter what, the pain and the disappointments and the anger, frustration, whatnot, they were always committed to each other. They never thought of leaving each other. They knew they needed each other. And that commitment, and I write about that in the author's note in the book, that commitment is what made this whole thing come out right. Because in the end, they not only found themselves committed to each other, they found themselves committed to recovery and committed to helping other people. And they spent the rest of their life committed to that. And then the second remarkable part of the story is these four people here who have done exactly what their parents have done, they are totally committed to continue their legacy and continue their commitment to helping people recover.
He was an out-of-control drug addict and alcoholic who had been all over the country trying to find out what's wrong with him. It got to the point that, well, he's writing prescriptions to himself. And anyway, goes before the judge, and the judge sentences him to 2 years hard labor in our state prison.
I went to him one day, and I asked him, I said, Louie, do you think I'm an alcoholic? Now, there's two answers to that question, yes and no. I was looking for a no, but I was prepared for a yes. You know, if he said yes, then I could say, well, he's just an old redneck. He don't know anything. I can justify it. But when I asked him, I said, Louie, do you think I'm an alcoholic? He gave me an answer I was not prepared for. He said, Bobby, if you take an honest look at you, you will know what you are. And that changed everything.
I would come in, there would be people in convulsions. I'd step over them and, you know, go to my room. And it was just like chaos and love all at the same time. You couldn't get from one room to the other without either getting a hug or getting thrown up on or something every single day. In 1982, I got a letter from my family that said, Carol Ann, we love you, but we've accepted that death may be the answer to your alcoholism, that, you know, we realize we can't fix you and we love you, but we have to find a way to go on living. I ended up living in a tent by the railroad tracks and homeless and waking up with leaves in my hair and really, really at a point that I never thought I would have to be. And that's when June 28, 1982, I woke up with a desire to be sober. God gave me that gift, and I haven't lost it since.
When I got to psychiatry, I was very excited. I wanted to know kind of more about the mind and behavior. And I asked my professors, I said, how does a sociopath become a philanthropist? And he looked at me like I had just driven in from Mars. He said, no, those are conditions that never go away. And I didn't tell him I was talking about my dad, who was in prison as a felon and diagnosed that way. And now he was filling our house with 25 people for free, trying to help them get into recovery. And I knew that wasn't registered. And so I asked, and this time he didn't know it, but I was talking about my mom. I said, how does a hopelessly major depressed person who is getting shock treatments, and even that doesn't work, run a hospital? And again, he looked at me like I was from a different planet. And I mean, really, I after a while, I quit asking these questions because they thought I was stupid for asking questions. But I was talking about my mom because she had had shock treatments, and now she was the COO. She was running Willingway Hospital. And there was one other case that, and now we recognize that addiction is the masquerader of mental disease. Even in the psychiatric manual, now a lot of people don't understand this, but in the psychiatric manual, you've got to get substance abuse off the table before you can use the rest of the diagnostic criteria for psychiatry.
She just loved alcoholics. She was one of the best counselors that I know anywhere. And she came about it naturally. She loved people over at Lee Street. You know, her running after patients. We kidded her about tackling somebody one time. But you know, she just loved it. We got a picture, and it's her of helping this alcoholic over at Lee Street drink a glass. I guess it's water or something. But, you know, he was shaking too bad to hold it.
In 1983, after my dad died, we ordered the prison records from Lexington. And on the very first page of those prison records was my dad's mugshot. And it freaked me out because he was an esteemed physician who had all these high accomplishments. And even now in his recovery, he had done a lot of things. And I remember shoving the records back in that envelope and talking with my family about timing. I said, I'm not ready for this. In the meantime, Bill Borchert was working on his Bill Wilson story and his Lois Wilson story. He was doing other recovery stories. And somehow he came to us and talked about the Mooney family story. And we all discussed this whole thing about the records and said, well, this is a higher power telling us it's time now.